So now I'm very pleased to introduce Haleyanne Freedman of MHolland, and she's going to be talking about 3D printing adoption in the injection molding industry. So Haleyanne, if you want to turn on your camera and audio and take it away.
Thank you. So what I wanted to talk about is the 3D printing applications in the injection molding industry. So I work for a company called MHolland. We are the largest plastic injection molding distribution company in North America, and we work with thousands and thousands of molders of all sizes in all different industries for injection molding. And I run the 3D printing portion of our business, which is a little subsection of the company. We have lots of different business verticals, but how we see additive is we see it as a complementary process and technology to injection molding, and we actually see it as a production viable process to start to replace some of these lower volume injection molding applications and a legitimate threat to injection molding as it is today. So I think has a lot of the actual production applications. I know we hear a lot of stories about automotive companies that are utilizing additive for different applications, but where these production quantities are already applicable to 3D printing is in the custom molding space. So there are lots of businesses that already exist that manufacture parts that are, you know, 20,000 per year or less. And in some cases, their entire business is focused on producing quantities of 500 and less. We think that they're the perfect production quantities to compete with 3D printing. And we've actually seen a lot of business from our injection molding side starting to transition to the 3D printing side because that's becoming more well-known within the industry. The geometry changes are the biggest preventative factor to the wider spread adoption, as is the 3D printing industry's lack of understanding of the needs and concepts that the molders need them to adhere to help us expedite the adoption in its current state. We also all know, whether you're in 3D printing now or looking to get into it, that the material certifications and the available materials also prevent a lot of production adoption. I actually used to work on the closed platform side and transitioned over to the open platform side because it's very, very difficult for you to take a closed platform 3D printer and the materials that are available to you when you utilize that technology and truly make a production part from that. Because if you only have three options for your material, you're not realistically going to be able to expand that further into your business unless you only manufacture parts with one single material. We have a company in Racine, Wisconsin, Racine Railroad. They manufacture all low-run production components. They make railroad repair equipment, so everything is in the couple thousand or less. They were looking to traditionally manufacture a bunch of new low-run production components with injection molding. And when we priced it out, it was going to be about $800,000. That includes labor, tooling, you know, all the associated costs. But instead, we were able to utilize open source 3D printing. They were able to get four machines that were purchased for about $10,000 as opposed to $250,000 for a comparable closed source machine. And with their entire total run costs, their components were about $25,000 for the entire run. And that also included the labor, materials, the actual machines themselves, et cetera. So here are some of the components that they are actually producing in the left photo here. But this is just one of thousands of molders that are in the United States and Mexico and Canada today that are doing these types of things and that have these applications that are viable. And I do believe that there are so many uncovered applications that we've yet to find that we just need to partner with these molders to help understand so that we can move these over to additive because it just makes more sense for everyone. So 3D printing is not an easy thing for the injection molding industry to just adopt. It's really easy for somebody to just buy a printer, of course, but yeah, they can start producing tooling, jigs, and fixtures, but to really get them to the portion of their business where they can go from tooling, jigs, and fixtures into actual production components is a lot more difficult than I think a lot of people understand. So the material variability is a huge factor, even the colors and the cost reduction, all of those things are components of the decision-making process that takes such a long time for these molders to adopt. If you're in 3D printing, I'm sure you say all the time to traditional manufacturers, you have to forget some of the concepts that you know about traditional manufacturing if you want to truly understand 3D printing and additive manufacturing. We have to do the same thing in 3D printing. You have to forget everything that you know and understand about what's possible in additive and try and understand the requirements and the certifications and the, you know, 50 years of history that is behind these requirements on these applications if we want to get them to that stage. They are slow adopters because it takes such a long time. The additive industry doesn't seem to understand that as well as some of the other industries. And I think if we work together to change that perception within 3D printing, we can better further the adoption in injection molding. The more we work on material development and certifications that are compatible with desktop 3D printing, there isn't that big of a difference from an industrial 3D printer on the FDM side and a desktop machine. If you can see behind me, I am a full-blown 3D printing nerd. I have 8 of my own printers in my house, and I can produce more industrial components than a majority of global OEMs can with their additive technologies on the closed platform side. But these molders are really the best target for production applications in additive because these are the ones who are actually selling the components in the quantities that we believe are compatible. So we do need to adopt a similar mindset and ask traditional manufacturers to adopt. They might buy a printer to play around with, but in order to get them to those production quantities, we have to share the education. We have to share the concepts like we are doing today. And a lot of these presentations, after watching some of the presentations today, this information is vital to the production adoption in injection molding. And the more that we can share this education, the better we can further this along and shorten that adoption cycle. Right now, we're predicting the actual production adoption cycle of additive manufacturing to be approximately 2 years within a mid to large size injection molder. And that has to do a lot with the tooling transitions, the certifications, the speccing of actual production applications, getting geometries verified, all those different really time-consuming processes that have prevented production applications up until this point. But we are doing our part in the additive department of MHolland to help share that education. And we hope that all the presentations that we've seen today and the people who have been hosting those can continue to share that education so that we can work together to get more of these applications into production. I'm going to pass that back to Jeremy right now. And again, thank you all for your patience with my technical issues. And just let me know if you have any questions.